Okay, right. So let me jump right in. Google Analytics, I hope I'm able to share some things that you've always wanted to know, things that we may know but may not know it in its totality, or may have a different point of view, or may have a different image about it altogether. Trust me when I tell you this that every day I learn something new about Google Analytics, and I've been doing this past 8 years, and I have seen the product change. I've seen the product change, trying to accommodate for social media, the evolution that happened, trying to accommodate for mobile and the apps, which Google Analytics very well unwillingly added a module for mobile apps also. And it shows that their product is still a little half-baked when it comes to tracking Google Analytics for apps. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to be covering broadly these four things. Google Analytics setup. What are the eight most pertinent points that you guys can use as a checklist? Ways to segment the data for greater insights. Let the insights guide us and guide us from the path of optimization. Naming conventions and best practices. Now, this is something which I've learned the hard way. I've stumbled too many times to finally deduce that you have to follow and you have to standardize some naming conventions for yourselves. And this is something which I'll cover very briefly. And improve your Google Analytics skills, which remains an everyday journey. But first, the sales pitch. Now you guys know that I am from Circle Slice. So Circle Slice is the new telco. I don't know how many people of you know that Circle Slice started our full-fledged mobile services in this year. But before that, I'd like to throw a question open. What are you missing out from your existing telco? Some things that you'd like to have, some things that you're not getting. Tell us.
Unlimited mobile data.
Well, you had a sneak preview in my slides, that's why you caught up on that. But tell me something really, something which is a real pain, something that smack in the middle of those mission-critical moments, you find as a ah.
Hidden charges.
Well, that's something which we all don't like. But then again, if they're hidden, we always obviously don't know of them. What else? Who likes to be binded in 2-year contracts? Tell me. Show me hands.
Actually, I'm quite okay with that.
Oh, there you go. I wonder if you're also okay when you want to move on to Circles Life. And,
I'm with Circles Life.
Oh, you're with Circles Life, but then you've already got.
He's part of our beta.
Oh, you already attained salvation, so we'll skip you. But then I think this is what we're talking about. Too long a time, we have now been shackled, and we've now been suffering from something like no unlimited bonus data, no phones without contracts. If you want a phone, and if you really want that phone for maybe $100 or maybe $0, you have to bind yourself in a contract. No unlimited WhatsApp. And pretty much people don't even care because to them, WhatsApp is unlimited. Well, you should have an eye-opener here. No true roaming. Now, when you guys, and I'm sure you guys travel, you would pick up a package, pay $30 a day, and travel to various countries. And it's a bit of a pain that you've only touched ground or landed, say, in KL Airport at 7 p.m. And because you bought a package, now you only have five more hours left before that day expires and the new package would start. Imagine if there would have been a possibility that you would pay only the amount of data that you actually consume at maybe 1/10 of what your prices are. Things like, if you would have dared to go without any package, a mere finding a way on a Google map would have cost you about $100. And something which shrinks to maybe $1. Now, would you like, I mean, I'm sure you guys like the sound of it at least. So these are certain things which telcos are not revealing themselves about. They want to still bind you in a package. They want to still charge you for those 5 hours of $30. And the next day, as soon as the clock strikes 12, you will pay another $30 for the next day. You will change, if you happen to change countries, you will again pay that $30. Imagine if you had a two-hour layover, or say a four-hour layover in Japan before you moved to US. You would pay for those 4 hours in Japan, the $30, and even if the day has not changed, you will still pay $30. Anyway, so that's what true roaming is all about. Hidden charges, we don't like hidden charges. And we want flexibility and control, don't we? You can zap that code, which essentially will take you to our website, and it will offer you this. So Service Life, we launched our services in June. It was full-fledged, full voice data and SMS if you guys still use it. And targeting tech-savvy people like you, people who understand how to use, how to get a cab through Ubers, get their food delivered through Uber Eats or Deliveroo, and people essentially who understand the value of an end-to-end integrated digital experience. Hell, if you want to ever port in your phone, you would never have to visit a website, a store. We don't even have a store. You go to a website, you can do a port in digitally. When I say port in, means you have an existing number, you port it into a new carrier. And ideas are powered by data. And that pretty much is the reason why I'm here. All our ideas, all our data-led approaches to insights in user behavior, be it on the website, on the apps, which essentially guide us, inform our now, next, and new. And there is a surprise waiting for you guys at the end of the presentation, so look out for it. So now back to GA. Google Analytics set up 8 points checklist. Google account structure and raw data view. Now this is very important. As we all know that we deal with multiple websites, and multiple websites have to have various views. But one thing which we also try and do is we try and create some filters for ourselves. These filters, when you create on Google Analytics to have your views segregated maybe by devices or by geographies, if you operate in multiple geographies, what it takes away from you is any changes done over a course of time, you will lose out on the historical data. And that's the reason one of the best practices is to always have one of the views, account, property, view, one of the views as raw data. Something that you can always fall back, something always you can extract and make use of. Most important, bot filtering. You guys are all aware that you've got a lot of spam, a lot of bots, a lot of click farms which are out there. Now, Google Analytics has been continuously improving their algorithms as well as the back-end systems to identify these bots and have added in their filters. Now, there's a specific place that you can find these filters, and you can exclude all these bots onto Google Analytics, and this is very important. This is something which is going to help you get a control even on your bouncers, and we'll talk about it in just a moment. Goals and goal values. Again, every business has a goal. Some people want to sell. Some people want just to register people so that we can send out newsletters. Some people, we want people to come onto our website, consume a video, or share. All these are nothing but goals. Unless and until you set up yourself some goals and assign them a value, you would not be able to gain insights in data and make use of those insights. If you want to increase traffic so that it culminates into higher conversion and your cost per conversion comes down, if there's a paid media at the back, then you need to establish goals. Now, these goals essentially can be established either on an event level or it can be established on the level of by URLs. If you establish them by URLs, if you implement them by URLs, then you'll also be able to get a funnel visualization, something which we can discuss about after the presentation. Personally identifiable information, or something which we all also know as PII information. This PII information is something which we typically either are not aware or we tend to take it very lightly. Google has a mandate of terminating your account if there was any leak of PII information on your account. That's how seriously Google takes this PII, personal identifiable information. Could be your email address, could be user IDs. If for any reason this were to slip through in your implementation, then this is taken very seriously. So watch out for this. There are ways of of creating filters to be able to avoid getting stuck with these personable PII information being slipped over. And if you want, we can go through the implementation after the presentation. Bounce rate, this is what I was talking about. Now, won't you all love if your bounce rate, first of all, how many people don't know what I'm talking about right now? Okay, so maybe I will take your questions maybe after the presentation. If there's anybody else for whom I'm being a little too techie, maybe you can see me after the presentation. So bounce rate, as I would assume everybody knows, it'll be great if the bounce rate is below 30%. Bounce rate essentially is people coming to your website but not going anywhere else. They just bounce off. That's how simple bounce rate is essentially. Now, it'll be great if it remains below 30%. I mean, 100 people came to your website, only 30% people go off. But one thing which people don't, which people may, you know, forget or take it very easy is sometimes any bounce rate which goes below 20%, they tend to pat themselves on the back. But it actually could be a problem, could be an error. And that is something you guys should look out for. If your bounce rate were to drop below 20% or below 10% for that matter, it is a point of concern and you guys should then investigate whether there is any double click double tags on your website. It could be that your website is tagged twice, which is actually firing the pixel twice, and then Google Analytics server tends to record it as two hits. Now, that is, and on the contrary, if suppose you're seeing a phenomenally high bounce rate overall, not only just from organic traffic, but even not only just from paid traffic, but even from organic, then that also calls for investigation. Not set values. Now, how many people have actually seen on their Google Analytics something which just comes in and reports as not set? This is something you guys can avoid by adding some filters, but be watchful of this. One thing you guys may have also noticed, this tends to pop up most frequently on Safari or Safari in apps. That is something you guys cannot avoid. Safari does not. Safari is still sort of trying to get their things around how to report itself in Google Analytics. So that is something which you guys still have to watch out for, or you know, keep it at bay. But other than that, not set is something that you guys can tackle by adding the right kind of filters. And these can appear when you run a landing page report with landing pages or page titles or host names or even sources and mediums. You might tend to see not set up or not set. Content reports. Now, on content reports, I will just quickly show you how many people have actually seen when you run a page report, you may see some links with just IDs. Now, while your links are the same, you would see that they are all differentiated by different IDs. Now, this might actually skew your data. In order to avoid this, It is advised to set up some filters. Now, again, it's entirely upon what the purpose of your business is. But one recommendation is, if you want to filter out any any parameter, any query parameters which are getting duplicated just because they have a different ID, then we should create some filters around it. And the last bit is, and the last is traffic sources. Now this is pretty much as what it is. You have to set up your traffic sources, you have to make use of your UTM parameters and tagging to be able to differentiate various sources of traffic and be able to then dig into and inform yourself exactly which traffics to maximize on and which traffics and medias to curtail. Okay, so quiz time. How many people can tell me what direct none source in Google Analytics is? Anybody?
Basically putting the address in your browser.
Okay.
And they just set up a search engine.
How many people agree with him? That's all what it is. Should I take silent as everybody agrees?
Direct and primary language.
So direct is essentially, and this is sort of widely accepted, that anybody typing in the URL directly on the URL is a direct traffic. But that actually is not the whole picture. Any traffic to the website that comes from any of these clicks is actually connoted as direct traffic. In fact, in other words, if you do not have a UTM tagged on your traffic, and if it doesn't come from an auto-tagged parameters, everything unknown is basketed or is bucketed under direct traffic. Things like, if you found a URL on Skype or any other messenger, if you found the URL on PDF, or if you found the URL on a mobile app, you clicked on it, the traffic goes to the website, the website or the analytics cannot make out where it is actually coming from. It doesn't even have the ability of putting it on a referrer because there is no website. There is no domain name. And therefore, it's all packaged under, in fact, look at this. Clicks on bookmarks. Now, this is a no-brainer. And this is something which I was talking to Google Analytics, and they're now trying to bring as much traffic getting accounted for and out of the direct bucket as much as possible. So fun fact, yeah? Ways to segment our data for greater insights. Date range. Now, this is a no-brainer. We all need to segregate our data by date range to be able to then compare and see if the changes that you guys made over the last week, how does the traffic has behaved over coming, say, from the last month or the last quarter. Now, that is what pretty much what date range segmentation means here. Primary, secondary, and tertiary dimensions. Now, we all know whenever we run a report, we've got a primary dimension, and we can also add a secondary dimension, right? Fair? Now, there is also a trick to add a tertiary dimension. And this is really, really cool. Let me show you this. Now, what happens is you have your primary dimension. Suppose your primary dimension is sources and mediums. You would just choose the primary dimension, and here you would see a drop down. And here you can change your primary dimension into a secondary dimension. And then after that, suppose your primary dimension that you first chose was sources medium. You click on Bing in organic, and then you go inside it. Here, suppose you change your secondary dimension to, say, countries. Now, it becomes your primary, your secondary dimension actually is shown as the first dimension. It shows countries. And here, you make use of the secondary dimension and make it a tertiary dimension and populate landing pages, the traffic. So now you have, within Bing and organic search traffic, you've got inside a specific country. And that specific country, you can see the traffic onto various landing pages coming from that specific country. So that I found something really cool. Basic table filters, now this we all are familiar with. You've got tables, you can filter them. But what makes it more cool is making use of advanced table filters. Now this essentially is making use of various options as advanced search, in which you will go into try and segregate the data by maybe a mobile device, or segregate the data using your regex. How many people don't know what regex are, or regex, however people pronounce it? I'm assuming everybody are fairly familiar with it. Okay, I don't know what to take from that silence, but let me show you what it essentially means. So this is what your classic table looks like, right? Here, you would see something called advanced. When you click that advanced, you will be presented with something like this. So you can actually segregate your data by landing pages, or you can add more matrices, or you can even add more dimensions. Suppose if you add a secondary dimension, source and medium, then you can create, you can use, instead of containing, you can use a regex, and you can give an exact parameter on based on which you want to see the report. In this case, however, you've got source and medium, and he's chosen the secondary media or the secondary dimension as the landing pages, and within that we can choose containing 12 weeks, and the bounce rate has to be less than 80%. This obviously will tell us which are the more higher performing landing pages, and therefore we can start optimizing our traffic to go to those landing pages. Plot rows. Now, on the same example, you would see that there are these squares, the checkboxes. If you were to click any of these checkboxes, it'll help you give you an analysis on a time spectrum vis-a-vis the parameter that you've chosen. So if your main parameter is sessions, you could actually choose specific plots, specific rows on which you would like to compare. And this simple trick actually helps you see how the traffic behaves from various plotted parameters or variables vis-a-vis in general traffic. Segments. Now, here we've always seen these segments, and seldom have we played around with these segments. But these are something really cool and very powerful. You could actually segment all your data by either mobile device, or by even if you've got an e-commerce website that you're running, you could even do it by sessions that actually converted into purchases. And then you can do purchases made. Look at this, made a purchase. Or you can even create a custom parameter which say did not make a purchase. All you have to do is go into custom here and use transactions equal to zero. And then you will get did not make a purchase. The more cool part about this segmentations is not only helps you segregate your data and be able to see it by those specific variables or parameters, you could actually make use of the same segments and create yourself custom audiences that you can further then make use of in the AdWords to run your retargeting campaigns. And that is the really cool part of it. You not only come to know which traffic has worked for you, you already have a segment which is already created and available there, and you can literally just populate or make use of it in Google AdWords. This primarily applies for custom segments that we can create. Custom reports. This is fairly standard. The same reports which are available on the on a standard, you can even you even have the option of customizing it, and then be able to choose the matrices that you that makes sense for you, and delete the ones which don't. And the last is admin filters. Now here, as I was previously saying. You could have admin. You could have filters, or rather, we should create filters around if you got mobile traffic that you expect. Like on our website, we would 60% of our traffic actually comes from mobile devices. 60% of our transactions actually have started coming from mobile devices. You'll be surprised. Of those 60%, 90% is actually from a mobile, from a phone, and not from a tablet. You could do a test. You must do a testing view. Essentially, any changes that you do must have a testing environment where you can check whether it's actually firing, whether it's actually recording the data or not. And if suppose you're working in various geographies, it is always advised to have different views by geography. It just helps you organize your thoughts and organize your data in an orderly fashion, and so that you can make more sound inferences out of it. So that's pretty much what, basics of ways of segmenting your data. And no matter how basic they are, they pretty much can help you on almost all walks of Google Analytics or Web Analytics for that matter, and they don't fall short from any angle. So now is the question time. Question for you with the bounce rates, of which I explained previously. What do you guys think, what is a bounce on a Google Analytics? Like I had previously asked. Do we all agree that a bounce is essentially anybody coming to the website and going off? Do we not agree?
I'm sure that's just one of the many possibilities.
Well, actually, it's just the only one in this case.
Okay.
But a bounce essentially is, if I were to put it in a very plain terms, is a single engagement hit. Now, what we know of is, we know of websites get visits. We know that we've got visitors. Visits are connoted as sessions on Google Analytics, and visitors are connoted as users or new users. But there is something called hits. Every interaction on the website is essentially a function of a hit. So suppose if you have had a page view. As soon as you landed on the page, it's actually considered a page view already. Now, if that were to be true, how will it define under bounce? The reason it can be defined under bounce is because then it is said that only one action, one hit has happened and nothing else happened. The guy did not do an event, did not go ahead on the website to culminate into an e-commerce purchase, or did not even click on any of the social plugins. So therefore, there has just been one hit. So a singular hit or a singular engagement hit on a website can be connoted as bounce. Now, who all will agree with me if I say, scrolling on a page, is it considered an engagement hit and therefore bounce will not be come into effect? Any thoughts?
Depends how you set up your script.
That's correct. So and that brings me to my point that bounce is something that you guys do not have to succumb to its default definition. You guys can change the definition. You can change it by something called a non-engagement or non-interactive events. It could be as simple as scrolling on a page. A blog. Now, a lot of WordPresses are actually, WordPress is used to create a lot of blogs, right? And you typically see the traffic which comes to a blog has a high bounce rate. The reason is because they've not customized the bounce rate definition. If your bounce rate definition entails that anybody who scrolled through a page, or even if anybody has spent an extra given amount of time or more than a given amount of time, then that can also be considered as a non-bounce traffic. And it has essentially become more important for us to make use of this, be able to customize the bounce rate, so that it gives us more realistic view of our traffic and analysis. Naming conventions and best practices. Account structure. Well, account essentially is you've got your account, you've got properties, and you've got views. But what we need to make sure is, if you're dealing with multiple accounts, and I'm sure you guys are, make sure that your account is either the name of a company or maybe the website. The properties, I'm sure you'll have a production environment, you'll have staging, and you'll have something called a Google Tag Manager. Google Tag Manager helps you create a testing environment. And views, raw data. Always have your raw data view. Then staging for all data, could be IP filtered, could be production, internal traffic only. Now, what it's essentially saying is, and Google Analytics actually helps us to create a filter on domain level, or rather on an IP level, and create a testing environment. Suppose if you work in an office you've got a static IP, and it doesn't work on dynamic IPs. If you have an office with static IP, you could actually isolate your traffic and create a property to be able to see and test out your website thoroughly and see how the traffic is flowing, how the analytics data is coming in, and it will not be open for all the other traffic. So essentially, it will be in a controlled environment. And you could do the opposite. You could exclude your IP, and that, in fact, is one of the best practices. Once you go out in the market, you must exclude your IP traffic so that it doesn't artificially skew the data for all the testing and all the hits that happen within the company. Again, disclaimer being that you have to have your own static IP to be able to exclude the IP. Campaigns. Now, we all run paid campaigns, or we probably run social campaigns. This naming convention has helped me quite a bit, and it's something which you guys should take note of. In fact, a few best practices, one of the best practices is that create a spreadsheet. If you guys build URLs and create UTM tags by the loads, I mean, what I do, you can zap that code and it'll take you to a spreadsheet which you can just download and just start populating your URLs and be able to create your UTM tags. Very simple and very handy. Don't pass the personal, again, PII information. Make sure that you guys do not pass any PII information. Set up Google Analytics on a lowercase filter just so that if there is any kind of... Google Analytics is case sensitive. So suppose if you want to track emails and you wrote email with an E capital, and then there are other times when other marketers wrote the source as email with a small e, it actually will not will start differentiating the traffic, whereas it actually is all from the same source. That's why you can avoid that problem by creating a filter on lowercase. Always test after setting it up, and that's when your testing environment or a testing view comes into play. Whenever you've created a UTM tag, before creating, you must test the URL that you want to create it for, just so that you don't end up with a 404 error. And after you've created a UTM tag, must always check. Because most of the times, you'd be surprised that 90% of our traffic tends to get lost just because you did not check that there was a space in the URL. And we all know what happens if there's a space in the URL. And don't wait until you forget to create a UTM tag. This has happened with us quite some times. We waited, we thought, we won't do it. We'll do it when it's closer to the campaign time. And then we forgot about it because the weekend came in. So guys, yeah, don't wait. And you guys can take a snap of that of that code. Events. Now, during the course of setting up a campaign, setting up a Google Analytics, we've got various events on our page. Maybe a classic page, what it looks like. This is a page which I borrowed from our website. When you enter our website, you would see that there are three dials, which are movable dials. You can create your own plan, take however much data you want, or talk time or SMS if you still need it. And so you'll see a bunch of clickable points. You've got the journey bar, you've got all these dials, you've got the help section, and you've got these links here, and obviously you've got the next button. All these events should be tracked. When I run my events report, I can track and I can run report based on people who have stacked up a lot of data on their plan and may have not closed the sale. Or I can create a report around people who stack up a lot of talk time, and that starts telling me and starts helping me dig a little more into what they want and how they want it. So again, we are seeing more and more that while we've given the option for SMSs, can you imagine the uptake on the SMS is less than 5%. People do not add SMSs. We've just given this because we don't want to alienate anybody and make them feel, there are no SMSs available. Having said that, you also have your pay as you go, and those rates are all here. So The point I was trying to make is, whenever you start a website, you have you'll have various interaction points. Maybe you'll have a video there. Maybe you'll have a downloadable white paper. And all those things should have an event tracker. You should track that event so that tomorrow you're able to segregate the data by source, by landing page, and even by time to purchase. And then you're able to slice and dice the data and be able to optimize towards the highest opportunity sources.
So if someone changes one of those dials to 5 or 6 gigs, 7 gigs, that's tracking an individual event?
Yes.
Five to six.
It's tracking individual events. And therefore, I will be able to segregate people who have built up their plans with 5 Gs or with 15 Gs or with 17 Gs.
Obviously converted or not converted.
Exactly. In fact, I can run a permutation combination and be able to run a report which tells me what is the most likable plan. In fact, I ran that report last time and I found out that the most likable plan, the most created plan is with 6 GB, 300 minutes and 0 SMS. That's the most likable plan at the moment. So yeah, I mean, then that also tells you that, okay, these guys are low to medium data users. Then I can actually create my media plans and my media pushes around that. Quiz time. So what do you think happens? What do you do if you ever, or if one of your colleagues were to make a mistake in creating those UTM tags? For example, I would always write, for an email campaign, I would always write my source as email without the dash. But Megan, maybe she wrote the email with a dash. What do you do? And that's a very common mistake. Any guesses? Well, close. So what you can do is you can actually create a filter to make it future-proof. If this is something which is going to be a common stumbling block, create a filter already which automatically searches and replaces any of such anomalies so that the data is standardized. Last bit, improve your Google Analytics skills. Now, this is actually a broad understanding. You gotta study. You gotta ask more questions. All the blogs and all the places always have forums also available. Ask more questions. I have learned and come almost this far because I ask more questions. Share. Because there are some people, whenever you ask, somebody is sharing, and therefore you come to ask. So if you don't become a part of the sharing community, people will not know where to get their answers when they're asking. Practice. This is where your testing environments come into play. Create your own blog, create your own WordPress website, and then test out, just for the sake of knowing and playing around with Google Analytics, which is such a wonderful and powerful tool. Reflect. This is where it all culminates. Reflect with your colleagues, in your work, in your environment, and thus for all of these things put together is going to help you grow. If you want to know more sources where you can study and pick up, you can take a picture of that code, the QR code, and lead you to a source where all the blogs are listed and pretty good learning sources of Google Analytics. So who wants to be part of the new revolution? We think Circles Life is the new revolution. And therefore, to give you a nudge, you could take a picture of this code and make use of this code to get a $20 discount on a registration fee if you guys want to be a part of. Essentially, Circles Life, what it offers you is, it offers you unlimited WhatsApp. What it essentially means is any data that you consume on WhatsApp, be it those HD videos or the calls that you make, all of the data will not be consumed out of your data plans. You can get as much data on your plan, and next month if you find that, oh, I don't have a use of it, change it. Dial it down. There are no penalties just because you decided you want to downgrade your plan. Sounds familiar, right? There are no hidden charges. How many of you guys who are not on circles just yet are aware that you guys are paying $5.35 towards caller ID charges? But that is not a charge when they they give you a comparison. The Circles Life plan, the basic plan is at $28. Ours is at $20. What they're not telling you of the hidden charges. So much so that we are transparent about the GST. All our plans are GST included. There are times when they will combine the GST on the basic plan, but they'll not combine and tell you the GST combined prices for all the frills that you add. I'm not taking names here. So, pretty much Circles Life was formed on one pillar, on singular pillar of doing right by the customer. Too many problems and too many shackles that today's Singaporean is living under when it comes to telco. And that is something we take pride in breaking. So, with Circles Life, you can be a part of the new revolution. Thank you.